Kings and warriors, epic battles and impossible challenges, these are, quite literally, the stuff of legend. And that's where we're going on today's episode of The Mythographist. We'll look at two stories that lie just past the misty edge of recorded history, set well over 4,000 years ago, when China was just beginning to coalesce into a single nation-state. The story of Xingtian, and the legend of the unstoppable, single-minded giant Kuafu. I'm Jaer Christie, and this is The Mythographist, where we look at the living folktales, myths, and legends from cultures around the globe. The stories that shape how entire societies see the world, but are often invisible to outsiders. Welcome to our first series, where we explore the most important and well-known myths from mainland China, and the cultural context that keeps them alive today. Yandi and Xingtian. In the days when the lands were still wild, there lived a great king named Yandi. His name means the Flame Emperor, and his kingdom prospers. His people grow both in number and in strength, and they learn from the great immortal Shen Nong, the divine farmer, how to use herbs to heal and seeds to grow crops. More and more tribes come to Yandi, and through the force of his mighty will, he brings them together. Together, they form a strong nation. But Yandi's is not the only rising power. His half-brother, the Yellow Emperor, Huangdi, rules a nation of his own. Huangdi's mother conceived him when a bright light fell from the night sky, illuminating the whole countryside. He is a just and fair ruler, compassionate and fearless, and his people love him, and in this way his nation too becomes strong. Though other kingdoms rise up against him, he defeats them quickly, for he knows that since war is a terrible necessity, it should be finished with all swiftness, for the sake of both countries. And his fame spreads farther and farther. It is not long before Huangdi's lands brush up against Yandi's. The land is good, but not good enough for two rulers. The valleys are wide, but not wide enough for two nations. Yandi is a proud man, and in time he grows indignant at his half-brother's insolence, and so he gathers his armies for war. Now among Yandi's ministers is a man named Xingtian. Xingtian loves music. He has composed songs for the farmers to sing as they work in the fields. But music is not his only gift, for he is skilled with his axe and shield, and his spirit is fierce, unyielding. And when Yandi's troops take up their weapons to march to war, so too does Xingtian join their ranks. The army of Yandi and the army of Huangdi meet on the plain of Banchuan, and there they go to war. Such a war this is, unlike any that has come before. Blood flows like a river, cries of pain echo like thunder. And the most fearsome warrior on the battlefield is Xingtian. His rage is a bottomless well. The Battle of Banchuan is long and brutal. It lasts for many days. It steals the lives of many young men and brings an end to many seasoned soldiers. And in the end, it is Huangdi and his army who stand victorious. The strength of many men is required to capture Xingtian, and though they take him, still he will not relent. Huangdi knows that such a man cannot be permitted to live, for the vanquished must submit to the victor. So Huangdi executes Xingtian. The executioner cuts his head from his body. But look, so deep is Xingtian's conviction, so hot his passion, that even execution does not stop him. For Xingtian rises, though his head has left his body. His nipples turn to eyes, his belly button becomes his mouth, and again he takes up his shield and axe. Off he sets across the land, fighting always, never ceasing. So if Xingtian found a way to persist, his spirit refusing to give up even when his head was severed, so too can you persevere through the troubles you face. As for Yandi, there are those who say Huangdi executes him and takes control of all his people. But there are also those who say that Yandi submits to his half-brother and is forgiven, and that their peoples merge peacefully once the fighting is finished. What we can say with certainty is that their two nations became one, and together they flourished, the first seeds that would one day bloom into the Middle Kingdom. Huangdi and Yandi are among the most renowned and widely known mythological figures in China. The union of their kingdoms is the purported origin of modern-day China. Well, one of several purported origins, really, but probably the earliest event on the timeline. In addition to these two emperors, Xingtian is a well-known mythological figure from the same era, and is a symbol of perseverance despite impossible odds. These three figures were likely real people who were gradually mythologized. Interestingly, at least for Western audiences, like the gods, these enemies are not seen as good or bad. They're just people who helped found the kingdom that would eventually become China. Huangdi is, however, held in higher esteem, and there seem to be more well-known stories about him. Banchuan, the site of Huangdi and Yandi's battle, is likely in modern-day Hebei province, not too far away from where I lived for 6 years. There are quite a few artifacts from that era, but unlike most of the rest of Chinese history, there's little writing, so it's difficult for researchers to piece together the truth of what actually happened between these two tribes. As for the historical veracity of Xingtian's transformation, I have unfortunately found little to suggest that it was factual. But we can all hope. Yandi, however, wasn't the last challenger that Huangdi would face. This next story is about his most dangerous opponent, a warrior king named Chiyou. Chiyou and Kuafu. In the lands of the south and east live the Juli tribe, and their chieftain is Chiyou, descendant of Yandi, the Flame Emperor. And though his forefather made an alliance with Huangdi long ago, Chiyou rebels against the rule of the Yellow Emperor. How can a man wage war against the Yellow Emperor? Chiyou is no ordinary man. He is a man who knows how to read the signs in the skies and the marks upon the earth. He does this with many eyes. He is a man of strength, for he has a head of metal with two horns like those of a great bull, and in times of war he rams his horns into those who stand against him. He is a man with knowledge of the ancient ways, and he calls forth mystical incantations with his fearsome voice and wreaks ruin upon his enemies. And it is Chiyou who is the first to forge metal into weapons, swords, spears, axes, and pikes, and he wields these with many arms. Now Chiyou fought one battle against Huangdi and was defeated. He retreats to the forested hills to the south of his lands, his army scattering in the mists and fog. But though he is defeated, he is not broken, and here in the hills he learns that more tribes than his oppose Huangdi. How does Chiyou bring the people together, and how can he rally his army? He finds a great fallen tree and brings it to the top of a bare mountain. There he ties his red war belt to the top of the tree, and he raises it and plants it again in the ground. And he gathers all the children of the villages around and tells them, "Dance and play your flutes, that all may know we celebrate, for together we are stronger." And people come from all directions, and there at the draped pole they find unity. And this is how Chiyou builds his army to be even stronger than it was before. Among those who come and lay their swords with Chiyou is a giant and the clan he leads. He is so tall that his head scrapes the clouds. When he is hungry, he eats an entire cow. He wears two great yellow snakes upon his ears and two more upon his wrists. Never before or since has such a man been seen. When Chiyou sees the giant, he says, "Greetings to you and your family. I am Chiyou, descendant of Yandi, whom Huangdi conquered. Now I go to take revenge." The giant replies, "Greetings, Chiyou. I am Kuafu, and I too am descended from the Flame Emperor. My people would be glad to join your cause." And Chiyou welcomes him, as he does with all others who come. But as the days at their encampment go by, Chiyou sees that something troubles the giant. "Esteemed Kuafu," he says, "your might is unequaled, and your stature most formidable. But your eyes tell me that something is amiss. What burdens your mind? Tell me what weight is laid upon your shoulders." And Kuafu tells him, "All men say that I possess this strength, but none dare challenge me. I seek to prove myself, but I fear to leave my tribe unguarded. And Chiyou thinks, and he says, know that your family is safe among the people of our alliance. All here are of like mind and devotion to our shared cause. But what is it that you seek to prove? For your stature is clearly beyond equal, and all know that your strength is without measure. And so Kuafu says, it is the very words you say that weigh upon me, for it is said that only the sun is higher than I. In all my life, the only one who dares compete with me is the same one who outpaces me every day, the sun himself. I see where he rises every morning, but where does he rest at night? I have not found it. Therefore, I seek to race him, that I might know the answer to this mystery and show that I am worthy of the reputation given me. At this, Chiyou is faced with a quandary. For though a giant such as Kuafu would no doubt steal the morale of his troops and turn the tide of any battle, Chiyou is no slave master, and he wishes to keep no man from doing what he will. And he thinks, such ambition is too great. I could never contain it, even if I commanded my whole army to do so. So Chiyou says, do not fear for the safety of your clan, neither worry that any man doubts your strength. Instead, do as you see fit. And so, the next morning, when the sun rises, Kuafu stands upon the eastern seashore, and on this day he races the sun, running across all the lands with a swiftness unmatched in all of time. He leaps over mountains, he passes over forests with a single stride. Rivers do not stand in his way, neither do cliffs or canyons, lakes or valleys. All who see him marvel at his strength, and there is none who doubts that the sun finds a true rival in Kuafu. As he runs, Kuafu is thirsty, thirsty as no man ever has been thirsty before. He kneels down to drink and scoops up water from the Yellow River. So thirsty is he that he drinks the river dry and goes in search of another, and likewise drains the Wei River. But still he is thirsty, and when the end of the day comes, he can find no more water. And so it is that Kuafu dies of thirst in the far west, having chased the sun all the way to where it sets. And indeed, the world is changed from Kuafu's endeavor. On the mountains in the east, one of his tremendous footprints still remains preserved upon its slopes. When he stopped to make lunch, he placed stones to hold the cauldron in which he cooked, and when he had eaten his fill, the stones that he left behind were now mountains. And when he took off his shoes and shook out the dirt and sand, the pile he left behind became a hill by the desert to the west that remains there to this day. When Kuafu died, his walking stick fell to the ground, and from it grew a forest of peach trees, which bear peaches even today. And so we remember the giant Kuafu, who chased the sun, his ambition matched only by the greatness of the task he undertook. Kuafu chasing the sun is another very commonly known folktale across China, and is often phrased as a four-character idiom. Interestingly, it has two opposite meanings. It can be used to chastise somebody who overestimates their own ability. You think you can catch the sun? Oh, great. You're dumb. But it can also be used to praise someone for having big dreams. Even though you know you'll never catch the sun, you still won't give up your dream. Great. But both Kuafu and Xingtian are well-known legends that currently double as fables, both encouraging persistence and determination in face of impossible odds. Historically, Kuafu and his tribe allied with Chiyou, leader of a dissenter state under Huangdi, and both were likely descended from Yandi. In some legends, Kuafu dies of chasing the sun, in others he is executed by Yinglong when the war against Huangdi is lost. The Shanhai Jing, which is an important mytho-historical source dating from at least 2,000 years ago, contains both versions. Some Western sources refer to Chiyou as the god of war, but from what I can tell, this concept doesn't really exist in Chinese mythology. Chiyou was a character of mighty, almost supernatural strength. He's revered as the progenitor of weapons and war, but he was basically still a person who is respected for his accomplishments, not the incarnation of an abstract idea. He's also the closest thing to a bad guy that Chinese folklore gets. He's not quite a villain, but it seems that since he was the enemy of the guy who eventually made the country, he's definitely not a hero, at least in China. More on that in a second. Some versions of this legend say that Chiyou defeated Yandi, which then forced Yandi to ally his kingdom with Huangdi, instead of losing, retreating, and regrouping. Putting Kuafu's tale in the context of Chiyou's regrouping seemed logical for when the two of them meet to make an alliance. However, I do want to make it clear that their interaction beyond their clans were allied is my own invention. The Kuafu story is mostly just Kuafu chased the sun and he died. A little more on Chiyou. Chinese legends aren't the only place he shows up. The Hmong people, who are found throughout Southeast Asia and are connected to the Miao people of southern China, revere him as their founder and common ancestor, a hero who fought off the power-hungry Huangdi. The bit about him gathering his army with a maypole-like celebration is one of their folktales of Chiyou, and I included it here to give a little more depth and nuance on this legendary warrior. If you know Xingtian, or Kuafu, or Yandi, or Huangdi, or Chiyou, I'd love to hear about the versions of the story you've heard. These legends have deep roots and wide influence all around Asia, and the more perspective we have on them, the better, because we can't learn if we don't listen. Thanks for listening to this episode of The Mythographist. This episode was written, narrated, and produced by me, Jaer Christie, with research by myself and Elena Tung, and music by Xiaoqing Luna Li. If you enjoyed this episode, we'd love it if you could tell someone else about it. There's a lot going on in the world right now, and sometimes it's good to have a reminder that we're all humans on this same pale blue dot. Finally, if you have a story from your culture you'd like to share, especially one that has shaped the way you see the world, get in touch. There are so many stories in the world, and the more of them we hear, the more we'll understand each other. Thanks again for listening, and I'll see you next time on The Mythographist.